Hello, it's our pleasure to have with us Professor Nirmala from the Department of Physics here at IIT Madras. She has been a faculty here for almost a decade now. Before that, she had done her PhD here, and after that she has done several postdoc positions she has held at IASC, at TIFR, at Ames Lab, in the US Department of Energy Ames Lab at Iowa. She was also at the SKKU in South Korea. So, and after all that, she's been a faculty here. So, a lot of experience in that process, working with research groups from across the world, and also, of course, with the research students here at IIT Madras. So, it's our pleasure to have her with us today. So, welcome to this
interview. Thanks a lot, Pratap, for this chance of talking to MP.
Sure, our pleasure. So, just to start off with, see, physics as a department, as a field, has been around, of course. It's one of the fundamental fields, and so, for ages, people have been doing work in physics. So, if you look at it now, what would you call as traditional areas of research in physics?
Okay. So, if you go back in history, you will find physics starting from, optics, atomic and molecular physics, and we still continue to work in these areas, and experimental solid state physics and nonlinear dynamics, and we have this theoretical and computational physics, and this is a very vast area. We can go from condensed matter to string theory and etc.
Okay.
These are some traditional areas that physics departments work.
Okay, so these are areas where there's probably a lot of literature from a very long time ago, and then somebody starts, there's a lot of stuff to look at. Okay, so also along similar lines, if you want to look at new areas of research, are there new areas that have come up, let's say, in the last 10 years or so, which a lot of people look at?
So again, when I say new areas, some of these areas were there all the time.
Okay.
But probably we are concentrating more recently.
Okay. Okay.
So, for example, high energy and particle physics, it grabbed attention after Higgs boson. And we have gravitation and cosmology, and we have soft condensed matter and biophysics, and quantum computation and information, quantum confinement, quantum interference, and the entire set of nanoscience and nanotechnology. And this involves low dimensional systems like graphene and similar 2D systems, and quite a lot of energy harvesting materials, and quantum phase transitions that happen close to absolute zero, and strongly correlated electron systems, and so on.
Okay. Physics, I think several of these are also, some of these are your areas of expertise. I think your area, you are expert in condensed matter, in rare earth intermetallics, you also work on strongly correlated electron systems, and also on magnetic and transport properties of materials at low temperatures. These are some, so you are working on really on some of the newer areas.
Newer areas, and of course, because it falls into experimental solid state physics, I would call that as traditional as well.
Okay,
so
fine.
There is some link. Yeah.
Okay. Now see, if you look at physics, again, it's something that comes from high school. At high school itself, students are exposed to a range of topics that that get described to them as physics. So they're very familiar with what is considered as physics, or the thought process that goes into all the things that we look at in physics. And so through high school, through the process of getting into undergraduate programs, and also through undergraduate programs, almost all of them have considerable exposure to physics in the engineering field. Given this, when people come in for a master's program or for an MS program or a PhD program, do they still face specific challenges in settling into a master's or a PhD program with respect to the physics aspect of it? And if so, what do they tend to do to handle such challenges?
We do have an M.Tech program and also the conventional MSc program under master's and the regular PhD program. So, although these students have exposure to the fundamentals of physics, their core physics, namely classical mechanics, quantum mechanics, statistical physics, electricity and magnetism, and mathematical physics, these needs to be strengthened and augmented. So, that is what we do at these level.
Okay.
Mm-hmm. So, in the initial semesters, they undergo a set of these courses. Even for a PhD, we have a module of foundations in theoretical physics, which deals with these core subjects, and we also have a foundations in experimental physics, which exposes them to a range of techniques and measurements. We also get some hands-on experience doing some basic experiments.
Okay.
Before they get into the actual program. So even if a student registers for a PhD in a theory, he does take this other course as well. So the person going to do a PhD in experimental physics will also be taking the fundamental theory courses.
Okay.
So that they become
So there's some uniform setting that they come up to, and then from there they're able to.
Yeah.
But any particular thing, like for example, is the mathematical skills? Do the mathematical skills that they have are they sufficient in the general general student community coming in for an MS or a PhD? Or do you feel that that's something that they need more work on when they get in?
Actually, we have a variety of curricula across different institutes in the country. Which is why we have these courses.
Okay.
We want to bring them to the same platform and start from there.
Okay.
So if there is any lapse, I think the student gets to
catch up. So now maybe if I shift focus a little bit. See, certainly in engineering, often we tend to see a little greater link between, say, the industry and what engineering departments do. In the case of a science department like physics, there are there is one aspect that first of all, the industry anyway looks at MS and PhD students as people who are specializing in a field, and maybe sometimes the exact and since they are a specialist, it's always a little narrower field, and therefore unless the industry is actually directly working on that field, they may find it a little less interesting to look at a particular candidate.
Yeah.
Now, in the case of physics, is this an issue? And if not, also, are there specific areas that typical physics departments work on which the industry is more interested in the immediate?
I agree with you that we work on more fundamentals often. So this overlap may be restricted to some areas. But I would say that this area by itself is large. For example, this functional and advanced materials comprising optical materials, photovoltaics, solar cells, and you have this organic electronics, oxide electronics, now the recent nano oxide interfaces, graphene oxide interfaces, and you have magnetic memories and spintronics, and I think these areas have strong overlap with industry.
With industry, okay.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And if so, so when somebody graduates with an MS or a PhD, what sort of positions do they get, both industry and otherwise also?
So the very common place the students, PhD students get into is a postdoctoral position.
Okay.
So some students also get into teaching in universities and colleges as soon as they graduate. And the students who go for postdoctoral fellowships, they come back and teach at institutes of higher learning like NITs, ISERS, IITs and IISc and so on. So this is teaching and research. As I said, wherever we have this industry overlap, we also have some R&D positions for these students in private and government labs, like defense labs, ISRO and so on.
Okay, and you mentioned postdoc positions.
Yes.
In science, how important is it to do a postdoc position?
I think it is very important to get this exposure and further experience. In fact, I think positions are offered to people who acquire enough postdoctoral experience. I think it's one of the mandatory norms. If you want to get into these institutes of higher learning, as I mentioned, I think you should have postdoctoral experience.
Okay.
It helps you broaden your skill set, overall values, because during your PhD you would have concentrated on one specialized area, and now even in that area you can equip yourselves further with more advanced techniques and so on, and then come back and contribute.
Okay. Of course, see, you have of course come up as, you have also done a PhD, and then you have done several postdoc positions, and then helped several postdoc positions, and of course guided many students by this time. So there are certain general perceptions on how we are supposed to measure progress in research. So we tend to, at least in the more mundane way, is to simply look at publications and publications. In your view, are there other ways in which you measure progress in research that when you look at a student, you say, yes, in fact, this person is moving ahead in research?
Okay. first, my own personal opinion on measuring the success of research or any work that you do is whether at the end of the day you feel good and satisfied that you have done a good day's work. So if you are going to measure the success of a research student or a research scholar, you should check when he or she graduates whether you have made some independent researcher, whether he or she is able to create a problem and also develop a methodology or a way to solve the problem. And of course, as you said, the actual measure will be publications in reputed and in peer-reviewed international journals. I think that's the usual way of assessing a successful outcome of a PhD program. That must be there too. And also, this research scholar must be able to present himself or herself before expert audience more confidently his or her findings. And this should be done in national and international level. One can do it by presenting a seminar or talk in a conference at these levels. And also, this scholar must be able to interact, or by interaction I mean discussion and collaboration with national and international level experts. So whether they have developed that independence and expertise over the years. And also, I think they should have developed out of the box thinking skills, their own thinking, their independent thinking. And I think one more thing in addition to publications these days is, at the end of the day when they graduate, the students must be able to articulate their problems, the problem that they create. In a manner that it fetches them funding.
They can support themselves.
Because now we have plenty of opportunities in terms of fellowships and projects.
So in now this, I mean, I guess to some degree we were talking of students as they, you know, complete and go ahead and so on. During their stay as a MS or a PhD student, so one of the things that we often talk about is that there's a lot of learning that they do by, you know, interacting with their peers, and also of course interacting with their guide or advisor. In general, in your opinion, how often should students be meeting their advisor, and what do you think is, you know, is expected to happen in this this process?
I would expect that this should happen every day. So, in fact, it can be as often as it can be. It is not like restricted to few times a week or so. I see to that I meet my students every day, and I think that is good. And maybe a more focused discussion on what has been going on can happen on a weekly basis. We can have weekly group meetings when student comes and reports more formally his or her findings. But otherwise, I think interaction must be on. It should be a continuous process.
So I think maybe sort of to conclude, what are your words of, you know, advice to somebody who is aspiring to do an MS or a PhD degree in physics?
I think it's humbling to be asked this question, but I think I would say a few things that probably I have learned from my experience and with my peers and so on. I think there is no replacement for hard work. I think one should develop good set of work ethics. And I think one also should continuously update themselves. So this is about the literature survey that we do in the beginning of the research. I think it should be a very continuous process, and students must continuously update in their own research area. And they should, nowadays we have plenty of avenues for getting these updates from international journals about the journal contents and so on. So they must be doing that. And they should also connect with their peer group. By peer group, I mean contemporaries, also the seniors and juniors. And they should interact with each other, and they should be a part of a discussion forum, and they should participate in the department level seminars and colloquia. And not only the seminars in their research area, but also in the other areas as well. And overall, they should develop the values of core physics, because when you come for a PhD in physics, apart from the courses, specialized courses that you do in your own research area, you must strengthen your basic physics. So this means classical physics, quantum physics, electricity and magnetism, and mathematical physics and statistical physics. So I think you should get this done if it was not done before, by the time of your PhD program. And when you sign up for a PhD, I think you have some inner urge. So I am sure the scholar themselves will do some self-assessment more periodically and keep growing. And the other thing I find often in our students is this communication skills. Very often research is teamwork. Not often, I think always it is a teamwork nowadays. So I think they should develop their communication skills as well, both speaking skills as well as writing skills. When I say writing, of course technical writing is also mandatory process. I think these are the points that come up.
Actually, in fact, you mentioned a point which I thought was very interesting about, you know, the fact that they should attend, colloquia of even other, areas and so on. In that context, how much do you think, at least for example, in IIT Madras, we have a physics department in the midst of engineering, environment. Whereas there are many other places where physics is in a separate, environment by itself. Yeah. So, to what degree do you think this has, assisted maybe, let's say, the physics, the students who are in the physics department here in a campus like this?
There are quite some interdisciplinary programs already running. I am seeing connections between physics and chemical engineering, physics and metallurgy, and physics and EE, physics and chemistry and so on. I do find interesting talks happening in the nearby department. I think one should check out, and from their point of view and perspective, they are presenting their results, whereas you have some view from physics.
Yeah, from physics.
So I have always got some interesting points by attending talks in other departments.
Great. Thank you very much for joining us. I think you have given a lot of very nice, I think input and also a lot of advice for the students aspiring to come in. It was a pleasure having you. Thank you so much for joining us.
Thanks a lot, Pratap. It was nice talking to you.
Thank you.
Thanks.